There's a book I recommend everybody read, particularly if you're interested in the technology and digital industry, called The Great Stagnation by Tyler Cowen. It's an e-book. Rather interestingly, it's about 15,000 words long. It costs about $2, $2.50. It raised the question, actually, why aren't all books about that long? Someone asked the question, do you ever remember reading a book which you thought was too short? And the answer is perhaps 0.05% of the books you'll ever read in your life, you'll end thinking, that was too short, I could have done with a bit more of that. And the great thing with the e-book is it frees books up to be different lengths. Why are all major books 80,000 words? It's nothing to do with consumer preference, human preference at all. It's bookseller preference. They basically go, unless it's that fat, we can't sell it for $19.95. So write that much. Now, one of the interesting things about the digital world in general is we will start to discover what the right length of a non-fiction book is. We assume we know. Actually, an awful lot of the length of a book is just driven either by intermediaries like booksellers who can't sell thin books, partly because about a third of books are bought as presents anyway, so they have to be a bit fat. But the great thing about the digital world, I argue, and you'll understand this a bit better if you do read that e-book called The Great Stagnation, How America Ate All the Low-Hanging Fruit, Got Sick and Will Eventually Get Better, is the subtitle. Cowan's point is that actually, we tend to assume that technological progress is exponential, but in many ways it isn't. It actually flattens out for long periods. Now, I'm not saying that a car now isn't better than the car in 1930. It is a lot better. But it isn't as much better as a car. A car now is not 100 times better than a car in 1930, whereas a car in 1930 is 100 times better than the car in 1830, because a car in 1830 was basically called walking or riding a horse. And there are limits to technological improvement. We have to acknowledge this. You know, yes, you can go from 4 miles an hour to 800 miles an hour in the shape of the 747. To achieve that order of magnitude improvement a second time round is just tougher. There's a third reason I'm skeptical about the doctrine of what you might call exponential and continuous technological improvement, which is, of course, it may actually just proceed at a pace which is either just inappropriate. The areas in which we innovate may simply be wrong. Because at the moment, we're paying a huge amount of attention to what you might call communications technologies and entertainment technologies. And it worries me a bit, because actually I think the technologies that will improve the lot of human life over the next 20, 30 years may come from a completely unexpected place. But my final point is that actually quite a lot of this technological innovation is going on without really any good idea of what it's for, the human benefits it will actually bring. And my strange contention is that if you're a marketer looking forward over the next 20 or 30 years, the real area of science to look for extraordinary progress isn't actually in the standard field of consumer electronics, or not the conventional field of consumer electronics. It's actually in a different kind of software altogether, which is our understanding of wetware or human psychology. Because at the moment, the models we have of how humans decide and think and behave and of what they value are extraordinarily bad. One of the reasons why, and this is, I think, something that's chastening to all marketers, only about 4 to 5% of new products actually succeed, is not generally because there's a technical failing. It's not even because people in research showed insufficient appetite for the product in question. It's because somewhere deep down in the human psyche, there was some obstacle or lack of enthusiasm in people's minds to which we don't have introspective awareness. Now, this is perhaps one of the most important discoveries of modern neuroscience, which is there are certain parts of our brain involved in decision-making which are quite close to the surface. We can talk about those, we can explain our decision-making, we believe we're making those choices consciously. But for every one of those, there's a large number of parts of the brain which are hugely influential in our decision-making, but which are entirely unconscious and appallingly disconnected from our conscious thinking. We simply don't have much of a vocabulary for the stuff that goes on in there. An awful lot of it's Darwinian. Some of it dates back millions of years before we even had language. Most of it dates back to before we had money. And yet we allow a sort of fairly simple, self-interested economic model the neoclassical model of economics, to dominate business thinking and decision making. To an extent to which most organizations don't even have a marketer on the board. They're content to make decisions without any single person in the decision-making unit having any understanding of psychology or human behavior at all. Now, if you want to kibosh this argument in literally four words, this is a sentence: beautiful theory, wrong species. It comes from E.O. Wilson, who's an evolutionary biologist. He's also the world's greatest expert on ants. And the reaction, beautiful theory, wrong species, was E.O. Wilson's reaction when Marxism was described to him. E.O. Wilson's point was that actually Marxism, or a kind of socialism as depicted by Marx, already exists and works quite well among ants. The problem is that humans aren't like ants at all. First of all, we're not closely interrelated. Secondly, most of us are actually fertile. Our evolutionary and genetic instincts, if you like, or evolutionary driven instincts, are just fundamentally different. We're more rivalrous, we're more status conscious. There are all manner of things that make chimpanzees and us, their near relatives, very, very different from ants. And yet Marx went and devised, you know, an approach which works in theory, provided you don't understand people's actual true evolved and adapted nature. I would argue that the neoclassical school of economics did something slightly worse than that. This is Milton Friedman up here. If you read contemporary economic thought, what you realize is that whereas Marx maybe devised an interesting political and economic system for the wrong species, what modern economics has done is it's actually devised a model of human behavior for a species that doesn't exist at all and has never existed. The general species is occasionally called by skeptical behavioral economists Homo economicus. And it's a race of perfectly rational, emotionally bereft, individualistic, calculating actors possessed of perfect information and perfect trust. Homo economicus, actually, in this imaginary world in which he operates, lives in a world where marketing needn't exist. And if you, as a marketer, wake up every morning and find dealing with finance people generally problematic, this is the really big ultimate reason, which is that many people in finance, the people who make decisions believing that a spreadsheet can tell you everything you need to know about your customers, by the way, that was an actual quote from a finance director. I don't need to see any market research. I can tell everything I need to know about my customers by looking at a balance sheet. Genuinely said. The reason for this is that they have a mental universe, an operating model in their heads, where psychology doesn't really matter. Everybody basically knows their own preferences perfectly, and where, as I said, your discipline needn't exist at all. And this is where it actually went wrong. As good Austrian economists know, and as good behavioral economists know, economics should be an empirical science based on biology. But in order to make it neat and more susceptible to beautiful mathematical modeling, economics basically cheated, and it did that. It pretended that economics was not a product of psychology, biology, and chemistry. It pretended it was somewhere between maths and Newtonian physics. And so it created this imaginary person to fit the needs of the model. Complete trust, perfect information, perceives the world objectively in ways that are always mathematically expressible, as though there were kind of a mathematical numerical unit for anxiety, regret, spite, uncertainty, mistrust. Okay? Patently not true. As though all those variables, by the way, were perfectly linear. Considers every available option when making a purchase. The theory is that when you go into a shop, you calculate which combination of the 30,000 items on sale there would actually most maximize your utility, a calculation which, if performed in reality, would take the world's leading supercomputer over, I think, 2 billion years. Free of complex emotions such as fear, regret, spite, anger, resentment, mistrust, or indeed affection, love, or the urge to reciprocate. And it's completely asocial. It makes its decisions on an individual basis, so it's unaffected by the behavior of other people in its decision making. Now, the problem of this species is that actually it couldn't survive. At least if it did, it wouldn't be a social species. It also wouldn't be very effective. In fact, it would find almost all decision making, in the absence of emotions, it would find actually making decisions almost always impossible in a real world situation. It could exist in a simulation, it can't exist in the real world. But the other vital mistake that's made, which I think is one of the mistakes that businesses most often make, it's the mistake that engineers make, it's the mistake that, you know, finance people most often make, is to assume that this entity has evolved to have an almost perfect set of senses which provide him with a completely objective and accurate depiction of the real world as it is. Let me just show you how this might not be true. If we can just roll the film there. Thanks very much. The brain absorbs literally about 11 megabits per second of data. What we can consciously handle is about per second. What we can consciously handle is about 40 bits of information. Unconsciously and beyond our control, a massive amount of data compression is going on, a massive amount of error correction is going on, and a massive amount of data is just being dumped or ignored as being not pertinent to our specific survival or reproduction at that particular moment. Secondly, our perception is hugely relativistic. We detect contrast much more acutely than we detect absolutes, with a single exception of perfect pitch. The human body, this is a discipline called psychophysics, by the way, the human body does not have a detector of any kind that detects any absolute measure, whether it's volume, whether it's temperature. We simply detect contrast and relative values rather than absolutes. This is Trivers, the great, well, probably the last century and this century's greatest evolutionary scientist. It's a very naive view of evolution indeed to believe that we have nervous systems that produce accurate images of the world. That's why, in one sentence, you need marketing. Because if you're obsessed with the objective reality of the products you produce and the services you offer, you may continue improving that objective reality spectacularly, but in a way which has no psychophysical effect. People don't notice. I'll give you an example. 4G leaves me slightly nervous. Why? Because although the download speeds on 4G are objectively much, much faster than those on 3G, the real thing that contributes to the human perception of speed is actually low latency, not high download speeds. That's why apps are popular. Apps cheat. Because when you touch a button on an app, something happens immediately. Now, in the background, the bandwidth may be slow and the technology may be grinding away slowly, but our brain thinks something happened immediately, therefore this is fast. I've already become half infamous for talking about high-speed rail. Is really the best way of improving the journey time from London to Paris, the best way of improving the journey from London to Paris to reduce the journey time at a cost of 6 billion and reduce the journey time from 3.5 hours to 2 hours 50. Actually, our perception of time is generally pretty feeble. If you're playing Angry Birds, time has no meaning whatsoever. If you'd spent the money on putting on-train Wi-Fi, the perceived journey time would have been reduced and the utility of the journey would have been increased more. Alternatively, spend $1 billion hiring all of the world's top male and female supermodels, get them to walk up and down the train handing out free Chateau Petrus to all the passengers. You've saved yourself £5 billion and they ask for the train to be slowed down. That's psychophysics. Just a bit more psychophysics. The square marked A and the square marked B. Everybody, I've never come across an exception to this. I have come across one or two people who claim not to see the McGurk effect. The square marked A is obviously much darker than the square marked B. That's because we're perceiving it contrastingly. If I change the context, what you actually see after a few seconds is they're actually exactly the same shade of grey. But psychophysics doesn't, again, work like a light meter. It's not one of those tricks where you go, silly me, now I see it. If I go back to the original, it's impossible for you to see that other than there's a dark square or a light square. Psychophysics affects all areas of markets. It affects web design to a massive degree, for example. You know, web design customer experience is very largely a psychophysical act. If you want to make wine taste better, by the way, two ways of doing it, which are much easier and more reliable than actually making the wine better, make the bottle heavier and tell people it's expensive. By the way, this isn't just their reported enjoyment of the wine, it's actually how you measure their enjoyment of the wine when electrodes are attached to their heads. If you want painkillers to become more effective, again, brand them and tell people they're expensive. The objective pain relief when measured by scientific instruments is greater if those painkillers are branded. Cues. This is a perfect example where psychophysics is absolutely, and psychology is absolutely essential. Most people with a finance brain go, we have a queue metric, it's duration of queuing. And we seek to improve that queue metric because everybody in research says that shorter queues are better. By the way, one exception is sometimes the opposite of your assumption is true. If you're running a nightclub, you need a queue outside, because otherwise everybody assumes it's a shit nightclub. That's why nightclubs employ bouncers to create artificial queues outside the actual building. So there are other heuristics and decision processes at work depending on the context. If we're choosing an airline check-in desk, short queue is good. If we're choosing a nightclub, no queue is slightly alarming. I'm too old for that sort of thing, but that's apparently what my young colleagues tell me. Now, if you take another thing with a queue, is there are several things that interfere with how enjoyable or annoying a queue might be. Enjoyable is probably stretching it a bit. Disney did psychological work on this, and they found that putting little signs that say 5 minutes to go, 4 minutes to go, 3 minutes to go, has a huge effect on making the queue tolerable. If there is some marker of progress, we're much happier queuing. The exact same thing is the software loading bar. If there's something ticking along in a bar, we'll wait 15 minutes for something to download. If you click on a link and nothing visible happens, you give up after about 5 seconds. Second thing with queuing, a queue that keeps moving, however slowly, is much less irritating than a queue that is occasionally stationary. You all know that from being stuck in traffic. Another thing with the queue is if the end of the queue is out of sight, people go practically insane. If you're made to queue round the corner, the degree of irritation and distress you feel is vastly greater. Finally, almost the worst thing you can do is have another queue alongside your queue, which is moving faster than yours is. But what I'm saying is if you choose simple, crude, non-psychological metrics, and most businesses now run on these metrics, which are designed by people who are desperate for a simple spreadsheet input, what you may be doing is depicting objective reality extremely well, but at the price of actually having appalling effects on the subjective experience. And there are hundreds of these things where our perception differs fundamentally from what you might call the objective measure of something. This is what I call the sweet spot. In designing any new thing, in any marketing activity, if you can hit all three, you exploit a new technology which makes possible something that wasn't possible before, it makes economic sense. There is some economic driver behind it. And thirdly, there is a psychological insight, which is something you've spotted but your competitors haven't. You're onto a winner. Starbucks, probably their psychological insight was you can't charge $2.50 for a coffee if you're a cafe, but if you call yourself a coffee shop, you can. We instinctively trust specialists much more than we do generalists. It's a whole thing called goal dilution and whatever. If somebody only does one thing, we tend to assume they're much better at it than someone who does lots of things and will pay correspondingly. McDonald's. Every single other competing restaurant at the time would have said, well, they would have gone out and researched people, what do you want from a diner? They would have said, really high quality food and a massive range of choice. McDonald's spotted two extraordinary things about food, one of which is far more than we are aware, or therefore say, people like instant gratification. No one in research would have said, I don't care about the food that much, I want it now. But if you look at people's actual behavior, instant reward, we have inconsistent time preferences. We have hyperbolic discounting is the technical term. The second thing is people particularly like food when it's very consistent, because an evolutionary instinct has said, you've eaten something that tastes like this before, you're still alive, therefore it's safe to eat again. Okay? Ray Kroc of McDonald's said, people don't want the best burger in the world, they want a burger that tastes just like the one they had last time. That's why anybody who's worked in McDonald's will know you toast the bun for a precise number of seconds. That's all three things, I think. You know, it's production line technology, if you like, really clever economics and psychology working in harmony. I think a lot of the world's problems are actually driven because people have a metric they're chasing, which is they're chasing it assiduously. They're not lazy, they're not incompetent, but the metric has a very poor connection to our own perception of the world. If you thought the McGurk effect was weird, there are many species of fish which don't see anything that isn't moving. By which I mean their whole field of vision is black until something moves in front of it. So the idea that actually our eyes are like these perfect light meters, our ears are like recording equipment, is an extraordinarily dangerous illusion in business. Here's my contention I made about 3 years ago. I've subsequently had it borne out by an experiment at Harvard. If you want people to complete their antibiotics, use that funny thing about putting a marker in the process. Don't give people 24 white pills to take. Give them 18 white pills and 6 blue ones and say, when you've taken the white pills, take the blue ones. They'll get to the end. Someone's tried it actually with different colors for different weeks. The effects are absolutely startling. This is probably more important in pharmacology than what's in the pills. Actually getting people to complete the course, compliance, is actually in many cases much more a driver of success than actually the differences between two relatively trivially different forms of medication. This is a really, really important thing. The single best thing the London Underground did to improve passenger satisfaction in terms of pounds spent was not an objective measure. It wasn't more frequent, faster, more comfortable trains. It was dot matrix display boards on the platform. Why? Because waiting 8 minutes for a train when you know it's coming in 8 minutes and can see it tick down is vastly less stressful than waiting 3 or 4 minutes for a train, spending those 4 minutes not knowing when the train is going to come. We have an obvious evolved horror of uncertainty. Another experiment, this is one we did in Woolwich. You assume that the only way to actually reduce crime is to punish people who commit crimes. A lot of crime is opportunistic. It's just people just feel in a mood where actually criminality is the norm. Grey shutters on a shop basically signal to our unconscious this is a high crime area, not very well policed, because if it was well policed, we wouldn't need all these shutters. Painting local babies on the shutters so far, now I'm skeptical about the exact nature of this response, but crime in the areas where those things appeared went down by about 18 to 20% after they went up. The shutters also look more attractive. Another point being, this is an Ogilvy experiment we did in Woolwich, a deprived borough just south of our office. The other interesting thing is we set aside a budget for repainting the shutters, because we assumed people would. They're English, they spray a penis on anything. Not a penny of that budget has needed to be touched. Nobody's vandalised them. If they're plain shutters, the graffiti starts really, really quickly. Here's another beautiful experiment, which I think exploits the sweet spot. The beautiful sweet spot. Does anybody know Halo? It's a London taxi firm. Uber is another equivalent, which you can actually use in Amsterdam if you're Dutch. Uber has just started experimentally operating in Amsterdam. Now, this is how it works, effectively. You see the taxis nearby. It gives you an estimate of how long a taxi would take. You press a button. You can watch the taxi approaching on the map as it comes. If the taxi is 10 minutes away, you can watch it approach, go, that's going to be 10 minutes, I'll have another pint. You can stay indoors rather than wandering the street in the rain, because you can now hail a taxi without line of sight. And you can pay by credit card. It tells you the license plate number of the driver, his name, in this case, Mike T. And it also, that phone icon means you can phone the driver. So if you think the taxi should have arrived and yet you can't see him, you phone the driver and he goes, no, traffic wardens, park round the corner, mate. And you walk round the corner and you find him. Now, what's in a way strange about this is I think this is arguably a more important technology than high-speed rail. Now, an economist would say it's completely trivial, okay? To an economist, this is a completely trivial thing. You can already telephone for a taxi. You can always phone in a taxi on an account, say where you are, and they come and pick you up, okay? So what's so special about this? Well, one, it's important economically because 40% of taxis driving around London at an average time are actually empty. There is spare wasted capacity in the taxi fleet in all cities of the world. So there's an economic opportunity here which wouldn't necessarily drive up costs. It would actually benefit everybody. It's better yield management. But there's a much more important thing. You can only understand this problem if you understand psychophysics, which is we hate uncertainty. Yes, you can phone and book for a taxi. You don't know how many rings it's going to take for the person to pick up. Then you have to memorize an account number, which is a huge mental transaction cost. Then you have to describe your location. But then you sit there and you don't know what's happening. Should I have another pint? Should I stay here? Should I go and stand up the street? Has he already arrived and I've just missed him? Once you understand that humans are massively unhappy when in a state of uncertainty, when they don't feel in control of their situation or in control of their circumstances, and you can imagine the evolutionary rules which might have given rise to this, then suddenly Halo, which delivers certainty, is arguably a more important technology than high-speed rail, which merely delivers speed. Speed is an economist's measure, that's a finance director's measure. Certainty is a marketing measure, it's a psychological measure. And marketing, my view, is that this new progress in the social science will finally elevate marketing to a point where it doesn't need to defer to science, to finance anymore, it can argue with it. That's always been my problem with the relationship between marketing and finance. It's effectively the Stockholm syndrome. You know, where people start to take on the characteristics of their abusers. Oh yes, I'll get you an ROI on that latest piece of activity. But what we're doing is we're allowing them to choose the weaponry for the battle, and they choose hyper-rational, sometimes wrong-headed metrics. The point of marketing is to say what you're doing looks logically wrong, but in psychological terms it's catastrophic. We need to fight back and contradict them, not merely defer to them. And the culture of obsessive, what I call this obsession with things like measurability, to some degree, marketing will never be perfectly measurable simply because the human brain is not a Newtonian device. Mass human behavior is more complex still. It's far more akin to weather forecasting than it is to building a bridge. So this obsession with what you might call ROI and accountability is, in some ways, it's very healthy. Because if you want to test, you need to be able to measure, and we need to test. But the idea of putting things to a decimal point is actually dangerous deference to a school of thought which is devising solutions for a species that doesn't exist. So these are five things. A man called David Rock talks about these as five fundamental values that actually evolved in us long, long, long before money existed. And these are five things we really, really care about. We can't necessarily explain why. We can't always put it in words why we just get disturbed. I don't think, by the way, I don't think it's a complete list. I think there are others. But this is a useful thing, partly because there are five of them and there's an acronym which is memorable. But status, certainty, autonomy, relatedness, and fairness. Relatedness is the urge to form groups and have an in-group and an out-group and loyalty and affiliation. You will see this, for example, at an airport, highly status conscious. Chimpanzees, by the way, our closest relative, are even more status conscious than we are. Certainty, I've already mentioned. We hate uncertainty. Autonomy. This is really important. If you allow someone to choose their seat on a plane and they choose seat A17, they will be much happier, sorry, 17A, they will be much happier with that seat than if you allocate them seat 17A. There are a whole load of experiments which show that our value of something is partly contingent on the fact that we chose it. That's why you notice there are all those funny little autonomous social rituals, still or sparkling, red or white, tea or coffee. It's because if you just say, here's your cup of tea, the person doesn't like the tea as much because they haven't chosen tea. Even if you say tea, if you then say tea or coffee and they say, I'll have tea, and you give them tea, they are more happy with the tea, not because the tea is in any way objectively different, but because they have chosen it. The lessons for anybody providing a service here in understanding that are absolutely immense. We just love choosing trivial shit, okay? I love it when I can book a train seat and I go, I want that one. Probably the most extreme example of this was the Victorian actor Henry Beerbohm Tree, who walked into a post office to buy a stamp, and the post office person brought out a huge sheet of stamps, massive great sheet. And Tree pointed to the one right in the middle and said, I want that one. Now, choosing, how we choose. There are 85,000 different kinds of coffee you can have, theoretically, at Starbucks. I suspect that 50,000 of them have never been ordered in the entire history of the chain. But if you use every combination of decaf, caf, flavoring, double shot, different kinds of milk, different size, hot or cold, there are 85,000 ways you can have a coffee. If you gave people a printed out menu like a Chinese restaurant with every single possible coffee randomized, we would go insane. The fact is we choose lexicographically one variable at a time, hot or cold, big or small, milky or not, caffeinated or not, and we don't find it difficult. But the path dependency of those decisions is extraordinary. Depending on what order we compare variables, the choice we end up with is totally different. Economists who believe in all this constant preference, perfect information stuff are generally blind to this. Also, we get disproportionately obsessed with trivial differences between things. I was talking to a drinks company, and I said, if you own several of the market-leading gin companies, gin brands, you probably think of all these small boutique gins coming along as competitors. They're not. They're the best thing that's ever happened to the gin market. Why? Because people obsess about trivial differences. That's what they create noise about. It's a way of demonstrating your connoisseurship. Small differences create noise in a category. The problem with the gin category was, compared to the wine category, it was simply a drink decision. I'll have a gin. Wine, you could arse on for ages about the imperceptible and irrelevant differences between a Chardonnay and a Chablis. Almost all the wine connoisseurship is, by the way, bullshit. Once it's put to the test. Sorry to tell you this. In my view, and it's a good country to say this in Holland, wine is just basically a drink for those medieval peasant cultures which were too backward to produce gin, in my opinion. That should get a cheer from the Dutch crowd, anyway. But actually, producing the narcissism of small differences by having lots and lots of different kinds, that's probably why wine is so successful. Freud called it the narcissism of small differences. And you see it in the technology industry. We obsess about the differences between Android and iOS, precisely because those differences are actually, in objective terms, so trivial. There's something slightly weird and wrong about our mental mechanisms there, but what can we do? But here's a very interesting example of path dependency and game theory. It's probably one of the most important lessons from the behavioral sciences. This is from an American e-tailer, an online retailer, where they found that moving one button, changing the word on the button, and putting a small sentence underneath it as part of the checkout procedure, that single change at a cost of $20,000 increased their sales over the next year by $300 million. That's what I mean by extraordinary small differences occasionally have massive effects on behavior. What was going on there is they first of all asked people to register before they bought. That violates some, and I don't understand this yet, some internal sense of justice. When I've bought from you, yes, I'll give you my details because you need my details in order to send me the product. Do not ask me to register before you have completed the transaction. There was something there, it was like a hostage exchange, which felt like handing over the hostage before you got the money. Now what was interesting is, they changed the word register to the word continue, and it said, you don't need to leave your details to shop with us, but you have a chance, you can leave them later if you wish. 300 million in extra sales. What's really weird is of the people who bought for the first time, 90% of them went on to leave their details. They were perfectly happy leaving the extra details, just not at that point in the procedure. Now, what I'm saying here is understanding the real psychology of our nature, not just what research can tell us, because we only have vocabulary for and introspective access to small areas of our brain. We simply can't describe most of our emotions. As Pascal said, the heart has reasons of which reason knows nothing. If we can just understand these things better, then marketing once again becomes the leading part of the discipline. Understanding psychology and understanding how psychology and technology can really work together effectively becomes, I think, the most important strategic advantage you can enjoy as a business. My strategy hints are, look for the sweet spot. Is there some instinct, is there some insight here which our competitors probably don't have because they're being too rational? Spot the dumbest rationalist economic assumptions of your competitors and say, what would happen if this weren't true? What would happen if actually making the queue shorter wasn't the most important thing? I'll give you a perfect example of this. I was giving this talk and a guy from a Portuguese insurance company came to me and he said, we were going to spend £300,000 because our call centre, euros, because our call centre was deluged with people saying, my claim check's too late, it hasn't arrived. Why is it taking so long? And we were going to spend hundreds of thousands of euros updating our systems and damaging our cash flows to send the checks out faster. And this guy said, hold on a second, there's no such thing as fast and slow in the human brain. There is in the mind of an accountant, but not in the human brain. In the human brain, there's faster than you expect and slower than you expect. Okay? He said, therefore, how long does it take at the moment? They said, 8 days. Every time you agree to pay a claim check, send a letter or on the phone say, expect your check in 14 days. All the complaints dried up. The only thing they got was a small trickle of phone calls from people thanking them for sending the check so quickly. The objective reality hadn't changed at all. The expectation had. That may explain the continued survival of Ryanair, by the way, which is that your expectations are so low to begin with that when you're not actually beaten up by the check-in staff, you walk away going, that really wasn't too bad, was it? Optionality, not optimality. Design strategy. Rationalists always believe you're trying to attain perfection. The instinctive strategist says, where can I go which gives me the most number of options going forward? I don't want to get tied down into something. And those two approaches, the obsession with the idea that real-world situations can be perfectly rational and optimal, is a fundamental false illusion of people who think the real world is like maths. It isn't. The real world's full of biology, meteorology, and complex, absolutely intractable and baffling and unpredictable systems. The sweet spot, finally, dare to be trivial. As that last example shows, there is no particular correlation between the scale of an intervention and the size of the effect. Most of us in business, because of the natural instinct to be in charge of large projects, once we get promoted, we get put in charge of big things, which are expensive, and it suits our own sense of self-aggrandizement to actually do big things. The slogan for Ogilvy Change is both is dare to be trivial and little ideas from big thinkers. Our aim isn't to find the £4 million things that make you £8 million. Our task is to find the £30,000 things that actually make you £10 million. They're harder to find, they require more experimentation, but once you understand that actually the way our minds work and not the way a computer works, there are surprisingly many of them. Thanks very much indeed.